Greetings. My name is Karla Spear, and I am pleased to be joining you in the Open Ed 21 conference. I am happy to be an OER fan and advocate, and I'm excited to have a small part in this conference and hopefully advocating in a way that will help advance and sustain OER, particularly in K-12 schools. I come to you from rural America, specifically Southwest Missouri. I have been a teacher, a counselor, a principal, and I currently am serving as a school counselor in a small district. For a little bit of background, I first learned about OER when I was reading on emerging technologies several years ago. And my interest eventually evolved into being the focus of my dissertation. One of the things that I looked at early on was Go Open. And in looking at the districts in Missouri, we had a large number, still do, of districts who are launch districts. And we actually had the highest number of school districts in our state as far as state members who served as ambassador districts. And I found that interesting considering that Missouri is not a Go Open state. So I did some further checking and research around OER and K-12 schools, and it led me to creating a phenomenological study to look at the adoption process and what led to the decision to formally adopt open educational resources in Missouri's Go Open districts. And in this presentation, I'm going to share kind of how I set up the study and focus mostly on the findings of the study. And I hope that that will be of use to others. And sorry that we can't have like a question and answer here, but I will try to provide information that will be beneficial. I'll get that pulled up. And to be completely honest, and probably like a lot of people, my initial interest in OER was definitely guided by the thought that this stuff is free. Why wouldn't everyone use it? However, that has been surpassed by the belief that knowledge is meant to be shared. And also by the belief that if public dollars have been used to create or develop something, then it should be publicly available. And that also helps eliminate all of the redundancy that takes place in schools across states and even across the nation. With all schools doing the same or similar work, recreating the wheel every time is definitely ineffective and inefficient. So with my study, just some of the research to back up the reason for my study, level of OER adoption versus the level of research that shows the usefulness of OER was out of balance, still is. In the New Horizons report in 2014, it even explained that OER would be leading K-12 ed tech in 3 to 5 years. So it's interesting to look and see where we are now compared to those predictions. And of course, while progress has been made, formal district-wide adoption and state support of OER is irregular and inconsistent. And part of the reasons for this study was the hope that by looking at the data from these districts, the patterns and themes which emerged could help benefit educators, school districts, and policymakers, and also help with the current lag in the widespread adoption. So it's not just individual districts and one-off districts who are utilizing OER. I did have the central question guiding my research about what influenced the decision to formally adopt OER in Missouri's Go Open districts. And then specifically the things I looked at when I did the interviews were the circumstances influencing the awareness, key players influencing the decision to explore it further, actions which influence the adoption of OER, and then of course what obstacles impacted the rate and degree of adoption, and what outcomes were observed. Because phenomenological research is based on a specific lived experience, it has been shown to be an appropriate approach for looking at experiences with technology like OER. Now, just to give you a little background on the participants who were part of the study, there were 13 Go Open districts in Missouri who could be a part of it. 10 district leaders of the 13 agreed to take part in the study. I won't spend a whole lot of time on some of these slides, which has specific information, but it's something you could go back and look at. You can see on the side of this slide, though, the differing levels of engagement, where their OER initiative either stands now or if it ever even took off. And I'll talk about that more in just a little bit. There was a very wide breakdown. This represented a wide range of districts with enrollments lower than 1,000 students all the way up to over 20,000 students. Free and reduced lunch percentages, the percent of students ranged anywhere from slightly below 20% all the way up to 100% of the students qualifying for free and reduced lunches. And then a little bit more of the demographic information if you would like to look at it further. As far as my initial findings, and again, this was, the research was done in districts who had already expressed an interest and signed on with Go Open. So there was some interest in OER. But early on in the process, it became clear that the experiences for the districts were very unique. After completing just the first 5 interviews, I had already heard experiences of never starting the process, even though there was a sign-on and some initial awareness of OER. The process had started, but it had been halted. The process had halted, but now they're reengaging. And some did have the ongoing OER initiative. This is just a graphic to see of the 10 districts, the differences with the 5 with active initiatives, 2 halted, 2 never started, and then participant 3 is shown at the bottom. Previously had an active initiative, then due to some circumstances, which did involve turnover in the district with leadership, the OER initiative was halted, and currently they are re-engaging. In looking at the research and information that was gathered in the district, you could look at OER adoption in different phases. For instance, in the pre-adoption phase, potential users could be looking at reducing costs, looking at ways to provide equity. However, still in this stage, users can be hindered by a lack of true awareness and a lack of understanding of what OER really is. In the adoption phase, benefits can be looked at, like positive learning outcomes, again, the ability to provide equitable resources. However, some barriers can come into play, like the lack of time needed, the lack of time for training, professional development needs that have to be met in order for sustained implementation to take place. And then in the post-adoption stage, as far as sustaining OER, even the most dedicated districts or districts with teachers on board, without having policies and systems in place, it can impact sustained practices. In fact, even halting or reversing the decision to adopt. And we'll look at that a little bit further and with some specifics from the study. So as far as the research questions that I mentioned earlier, when it came to the awareness of OER, this is just an example of how sporadic it is in learning about OER. 7 of the district leaders learned about OER due to their own personal research and seeking it out. 2 received unsolicited invitations to a particular training, and then 1 learned about it and became aware of it because a former employee of the district had initiated OER exploration. Often the key players were pretty consistent. Out of the 10, curriculum directors were involved, or the curriculum team. Teachers were a part. Most included either the superintendent or then the assistant superintendent or both. Communication was certainly a key factor in deciding whether or not to adopt professional development. And keep in mind when you see the 5 behind it and some of the numbers as far as actions to adopt, keep in mind two of the districts never even started the process, and 2 of them started but halted the process. So as far as continuing to adopt, professional development, communication were key. Some of them were looking at reallocating money, and then 2 really had the focus on saving money. So that was definitely not the majority of the focus. The obstacles which were encountered, 8 of them, and this also impacted the ones who had active initiatives as well as the ones who chose not to continue on: lack of time, complexity, and then some, the mindset or unwillingness to look at something different and veer off of the traditional way of purchasing textbooks. And a quote that came up a couple of times, and people who have been in OER for a while may have heard it, because I guess it's kind of a popular phrase. And once I learned more about the experiences, it made a lot of sense. So I heard a couple of times that OER can be free like a puppy. Just attractive at first, and you have to keep in mind all the things that come along with it. Outcomes of OER. It was very interesting to hear from the districts who had ongoing initiatives, and it had become a part of their practice in their district, that the teachers' knowledge of the standards and the impact on instruction was a significant outcome. And then also high up there was the ability to address equity concerns in the district. And again, 4 of the 8 districts who had implemented and utilized OER said those things. A topic that really wasn't on my agenda as far as a specific research question, but it did come up in 6 of the 10 interviews: the absence of the state leadership played a role, they felt, in the widespread adoption of OER, at least in the state of Missouri. Because of a lack of awareness of OER, which is often the case, it puts additional burdens on the districts and district leaders and teachers to go ahead and find and vet resources. One participant even explained how they still talk to people now that don't have any idea that it exists. And of course, this common pattern, which emerged, it developed into one of the themes, and it certainly has implications going forward. So barriers and strategies. We know there can be barriers to change, but I really want to talk about the strategies that can help make a difference. So certainly the lack of understanding was and continues to be at times a significant obstacle. What is it? Where do we find it? How do you use it? And then of course, time, because teachers only have a limited amount of time, and implementing OER effectively does take time. So certainly a barrier. In the participant districts, though, with active initiatives, their sustainability in keeping OER in place has been positively impacted by a strong advocate But with forward thinking leadership behind it, and instead of just it being, I don't know, a random decision, a focus is placed that when resources are adopted in some of the districts with the active initiatives, it was digital first, or it was something that was written up in policy or procedure that had to be considered or at least looked at. Didn't mean that it was required, but it had to be a consideration. So systematic procedures made a difference, of course, in sustaining OER use, so that it wasn't just a done one time, and if someone leaves, it's not done any longer. So continuing on with barriers and strategies, I did utilize Roger's work in setting up my study and then in looking at the findings. So utilizing Roger's perceived attributes of innovation, you'll see his innovations on the left side of the screen, and then the positive influence it had or the negative influence. So in looking at the relative advantage piece, whether or not this was a relative advantage in deciding whether or not to utilize OER, the positive part would be the reallocation of funds, not necessarily on the saving money, but how can those funds be reallocated to better serve the district and the district students. Having a better product that fits us, and these are all direct quotes from the participants in the study, a great opportunity, expanding access. Now on the other side, the negative influence, one district leader said, it didn't catch on. OER can be overwhelming. And then the unknown aspect. So that goes back to the unwillingness or mindset about changing to something that's unknown. Compatibility, along the positive side, districts that were looking at using more technology, districts that were focused and already looking towards diversity, equity, and inclusion, the DEI that came up in several interviews, a district that was a digital first district, this was very compatible utilizing OER with. On the negative side, and you'll see it in a couple of areas, the change in leadership or other district initiatives going on in their districts, they didn't feel like it was a good match. The complexity part, it is complex. Change. However, the districts that had success, teachers who were willing, there was a good strategic plan in place, and then a very heavy emphasis on the PD side, which is very important to keep in mind. And again, on the negative side, the big leadership change was huge. Turnover that could impact or reverse a decision. Does take a lot of time. And then some still found the copyright law as a little hard to navigate, which impacted whether or not to proceed on. And then under trialability and observability, relationship piece, that was a big part in some of the districts who were systematically utilizing OER and already fostered relationships. Know your teams and your people. So that was already in place. So there was a lot of trust and working together. It wasn't just one person dictating. And then observing how it impacted things, it's become the way we do things. It's been internalized, and that impacted the sustainability in those districts. So in looking at the themes which emerged from my research, there's certainly a need for time and professional development. It takes a lot of time to get to know it and be comfortable with exploring it more. So administrators and leadership, if they want OER to last, have to realize that PD has to be a big part and dedicate time to letting teachers have that time, but it will pay off in the end. Focusing on reallocation of money rather than saving money. Some of the districts who looked at saving money were not the ones who continued on and had a sustained OER initiative. the thought of why would you pay for something if you can get it for free could be the catch. But with planned reallocation, it moves on from that and allows teachers the opportunity to study. They learn their content better. They learn standards better when they are actually looking at it that way. And some districts specifically reinvested that money into the PD for the teachers and gave them paid time to truly look at their curriculum and see what resources matched up. So they still were spending the money. They were just spending it in a way instead of just spending it on a purchased book and not spending the time to actually look and see how that matched up to the standards. They were investing in the teachers to help them better learn their standards and find the resources that best matched and allow them to teach their curriculum to benefit the students. And then the third theme which emerged was the importance of leading with systems and policies and not just an OER advocate. While the advocate can get things going and kick things off, as one of the participants said, when it's not mechanisms and systems that are leading the way, it's people leading the way and people move. And that did impact some of the initiatives. If you're just relying on that cheerleader or that advocate and something should happen that they move or leave the district, the momentum could leave with them. Professional implications, very important in looking at this, to think about what needs to be done to make a difference. So prioritizing time and professional development, like I already mentioned. The focus on reallocation of resources. As one district leader said, the teachers can look at in that district as OER, as the district just being cheap and wanting teachers to do more work. But if the resources are reallocated, then districts can look at how to spend that money in the right way. So it's just a different way of looking at it. And then developing systems policies and even state level OER leadership. Because that turnover and change in leadership can negatively impact OER use and adoption, it's important to have those policies and systems running things. And then one participant speculated that at least within the state of Missouri, it won't be possible to have widespread OER adoption and at the state level until we have a bigger voice. So for it to move from just the individual districts, they felt like the state needed a larger voice, just like we see in some of the states who have a larger OER network. Finally, in looking at some of the conclusions and recommendations, a few things that are important to remember and a few things that can help with this, especially with the awareness part, is because the awareness and understanding isn't always there, university training programs for pre-service teachers as well as administrators, if those were looked at and reviewed, it could help ensure that OER is presented to those new teachers and administrators so that they better understand it and can lead their districts that direction. Additionally, there is still a significant misunderstanding, and I even found that to be true sometimes in the interviews, interchanging curriculum for resources, just the misunderstanding of how different those things are and the part that resources play. So that could help if that was effectively addressed, it could help also in advancing OER. And then finally, policy changes at the state level, instead of it relying on standalone districts to do all of the work, that would be allowing taxpayer dollars to be spent more effectively and efficiently, which of course would positively impact students in the long run. I do have my references up there, and I have more if anyone was interested, but I just want to close with this thought. Of course, do the best you can until you know better, and then when you know better, do better. So I'm always trying to do better, and I hope that you gained a little bit from this presentation, and I wish you the very best, and please reach out if you have any questions, and if I can help in any way, I'd be happy to share more of my research if you're interested, and I hope you have a great conference. Thank you very much.